Yeah. Okay, welcome. I will introduce myself. I'm Maarten Boon, and I work for Zerocopter, and my job there is basically to break stuff. And this project, hijack.net, actually started with a hackathon that we were invited to do to test the security of body cams. And when we started out, we were split into two teams. One team was put on the hardware part of the body cam, and I was put with a few people on the software part. The first thing we found out was that the management software that was used for the body cams was written in .NET. The nice thing about .NET is that it's a managed language, so it's fairly easy to, for example, decompile it. Except in certain cases, for example, when they've used obfuscation or other types of anti-decompilation techniques. Another problem with the software was that it required a license to run, and we didn't have a license. The next problem was that basically we could see that all the functionality that we needed to communicate with the body cam was actually present in a separate DLL that came with the application. So the second goal became being able to load parts of the original management software as a library in our own software, and then talk and communicate with it as if you were communicating with any regular other library. However, to do this, it actually required a lot of manual work. As you can see here, yeah, the resolution isn't that great, but first you have to load the target, so the software that you actually want to extract certain functionality from. Then you need to resolve the type and then turn the type into an object, and then you can talk to the object. But every single object that is implemented in the original version, you have to implement manually, line by line in your own code. So that's all of this is actually a lot of work. And the goal was actually to create a tool that can do all of this without writing a single line of code, and with very little knowledge of how .NET works internally. So it's based on a few third-party libraries. The first one is Zero Harmony, also called Harmony 2, which is the main hooking library that we use. Then we use Mono Mod, which is another hooking library, which is part of Harmony 2. Then we use Mono Sessil, Native Sharp, Newtonsoft JSON, MQTT Net, and Costura Fodi. So a little bit of background. Harmony is actually a patching framework for .NET applications that allows you to define a patch in a very high level way. So for example, this is a patch. So as you can see, for every single patch that you need to do, you need to write a class with an initializer, and you need to write a whole bunch of code. So the other goal became to create a wizard that would generate this basically all. So as I will show you later, Mono Sessil is the library that we use to actually parse .NET assemblies, and then we turn it all into a tree view, as you can see here. And then basically, if you load an application, you will get a list of all the namespaces that are defined within the application, all the classes that are defined under the namespaces, and all the methods, the constructors, and all the properties. And you can actually interact with every single function here, and you can manipulate the input, you can manipulate the output, you can log the input, log the output. You can basically do whatever you want, and again, without writing a single line of code. Another library that we use, but it's only on the Windows version, is Native Sharp, and we use that to inject our hooking library into another .NET process and then interact with it. Newton JSON is basically just a general purpose JSON library. All the rules and the hooks that we generate are all combined into a single JSON file, and the JSON file actually tells the engine what to do in the end. So you don't have any fixed code for certain functionality within the engine, but you can extend the engine just by sending a bunch of JSON to it that it can parse, and then it can use that to apply hooks or start logging or whatever you want to do. To make it easy to manage, I've decided to move everything to MQTT. Is everybody familiar with that? That's a protocol that is also used for IoT devices and large-scale infrastructure management, and we use this as a client as well as a broker. Then the last is Costura Fodi, but this is actually a post-built tool, so all the separate libraries that we've just discussed will be merged after build into a single library, so it's easy to inject into another process, otherwise you would need to inject multiple files all at once. So all combined, hijack.net is actually based on three different components. You have the hijack.net wizard that you can use to start a new project and add binaries to it and analyze the binaries, start hooks. And then there's the core loader, which will be used to inject into the process that you want to interact with, and it will get fed all the rules and the hooks that you have defined within the wizard. Then there's the native loader, which is only available on Windows, and it's actually a stepping stone to make it easier to inject a .NET binary into another process. So let's see how the process works. So basically the first step when you start the wizard is just click file, start a new project, add a target, then it will load the binary, and it will look something like this. So I took the MS Core library as an example, and as you can see, it will be shown in a tree view with the assembly name of top on top, then all the names of the modules contained within the assembly, as well as a list of all the namespaces and the classes defined within that namespaces, as well as the methods, basically everything that is in the binary and that you can interact with. So as soon as you actually select one of the methods, it will actually add it to the hooking configuration. And as soon as you click it there, you can actually select, for example, which parameters of the function you want to log. If you want to log, for example, the return value, if you want to modify the return value, so in this case, it's a GUID, so you will actually get a hex editor input that you can use to input a new one. We made it easier to load. You can also right click and then select a file with the content that you want to load into there. Then there are also loggers for a specific type. So in this case, it's, for example, RSA parameters that is a value used in the RSA implementation of .NET. So for example, if you put a bunch of hooks into those libraries, you could use it to log or manipulate someone's RSA keys, for example. But the nice thing about a typed logger is that it also works on structures, and you can actually select which field of the structure you want to log. So if it's not all interesting, you can just pick the parts that you're interested in. Then there's also custom type loggers. If you want to do really crazy stuff with the stuff that comes in, it's basically a templating engine that supports full-blown C#. All the code that you write here will also be added to the hooking configuration. It will be sent to the process that is running the hooking engine at that very moment, and it will compile all this code on the fly and also apply it in your workflow. So once you've finished creating one of these hooks, it will actually be turned into a whole bunch of JSON, and this will be compressed and base 64 encoded, and then you can feed it to the engine. The engine will unpack it, apply all the hooks, and then it will start logging or whatever you've defined for the rules to be doing. Then there's also another way of starting a project, which is called a targeting helper. And the targeting helper gives you two options. For example, you can select a file. So you can select a .NET binary, and then it will automatically extract the version of the runtime, the architecture that it uses, and the .NET framework version that you need to use. And you can also do this with processes. So you can also do it with running processes, for example. Then there's a few different ways of injecting your binary into the target. You could do a side loading, which is a core host, which is actually a configuration file that you put in the target's directory, and it will automatically load your DLL as soon as the application starts, and then you can apply your hooks. Another way of doing it is actually patching it into the target. Then it will actually modify the target binary to first load your binary, apply all the hooks, and then continue to the original entry point of the binary. And the other two are used for live processes. So you can actually inject it into something that is already running and then apply all the hooks. So now what? So basically what's going to happen is you have your hijack .NET wizard, which you use to create rules. All the rules will be turned into JSON and pushed to an MQTT broker. The broker has a bunch of clients in the form of all your engines that you have injected into your targets, and they will first get the configuration to use from the central broker, apply it, and then all the stuff that is going to log will be logged back to the MQTT broker. And the nice thing about MQTT is that it's very easy to interface, so you can also write custom tooling, for example, to collect logs. There's a whole bunch of API calls you can send to the .NET loader. You can make it stop, start. You can, for example, attach a console to the process that you have injected in, which is easy if you're debugging, for example, because you can output all your traces onto that. You can actually make it unhook everything you've just hooked. You can clear all the hooks. You can load additional hooks or new hooks, and all of this is on the fly. So you can do this while the processes are running. Then there's also an option to save the hooks that are currently active within the process. So it will extract all the hooks, turn them back into JSON and yeah? Oh, I do it there. And the last one is execute code, and that's Yeah, it's working. So the last one is execute code, and it actually allows you to just inject a whole bunch of C# code that you have just coded yourself, and it will be executed within the context of the target process, and then you can basically talk to everything that is contained within the process. So it also doesn't really matter if a function that you want to talk to is, for example, public or private, because it doesn't really distinguish between all of those. You can actually talk to everything. Also, properties, for example, that were originally read-only, you could actually overload them and make them reply with a different value. So that's for custom tooling, but since it's MQTT, you can even go more nuts. So you can actually connect it to your home assistant. And then again with Google or Alexa, and then you can actually give voice commands to whatever you have running there. So that could be a rootkit or whatever you've made. So, yeah? Oh no, it's if yeah. So then some ideas for the future, because the wizard is now Windows only, and it's a binary, and you need to install it, and that's a lot of work, and you have to maintain it. So one of the ideas is to actually make the complete wizard, and everything you can do with it completely web-based, so you can do everything that I've just showed you, but then from your browser. Another thing that would be nice is to be able to create hook and rule packages, a bit like with Yara, that you can actually export and share within the community, for example. Then there's also the text-based editor, so you can actually write all the JSON for the hooks and the rules yourself, if you hate fun. And there will also be a native code API, so you can also use the engine I just showed you against native applications. Another thing I forget is that it works on every single version of .NET. It doesn't really matter if it's 64 bits, 32 bits, or ARM. You only have to compile it once, because every binary that we build is actually any CPU binary, so it doesn't really matter where you run it. And last but not least, we would like to add plugin support. So for example, if there's another architecture that we don't support, then you can actually write a
plugin for that. So, thank you. That's it. Are there any questions? Yeah.
You mentioned bootkits, but what if you want to deploy this in production? Will people start complaining that everything gets slow?
No.
Is there some like
you don't you don't notice it at all, because with traditional code hooking, you usually actually replace parts of the code you detour to other code. The nice thing about .NET is everything that happens in memory is basically one big V table. So it's you basically just have to replace one value, and then you have an active hook.
Virus scanners think of this?
Yeah, nothing really.
Can you also use this to measure execution times of certain code blocks, etc.? So use
yes,
profiling, that sort
yeah,
of stuff?
Yeah, you can use it for debugging, profiling. You could actually use it to build shims, for example, to give certain applications backwards compatibility. You can basically do everything you can do with .NET, you can also do with this, but you can do everything with your mouse. So you don't have to write any code yourself.
So how did you get from a project with cameras to this?
Yeah, that's...
It's very
that's always a big question. I have ADD, so that could explain it a bit. I hope so. We don't know yet. We first need to check if there's actually interest. We need to do a lot more testing before we can actually deploy this in production. But you could, for example, also use this within PowerShell, because PowerShell is basically also fully based on .NET. So you could, for example, use this to create some kind of firewall that will actually capture all those nice little one-liners that will normally start a shell, but since you can control everything that comes in and out, you could also replace the backdoor shell that is incoming with, for example, a GIF of Rick Ashley.
Secure environments and all that sort of stuff Microsoft is talking about are all the rage, and we have signed binaries, but you're not touching the binary, you're injecting into IL in memory probably, so the binary doesn't get touched. What way is there for software developers to protect their applications against attacks like these?
Well, if you really want to protect against this, it's possible, but for starters, you need a kernel driver. You could use an OOB register callback driver. That's a callback that is called when a handle to a certain process or a file is opened. So for example, if you're in that callback and you detect that someone is trying to open a handle to your process, you could actually lower the privileges. So you could still allow it to, for example, read your process, but you could take away, for example, the write flag. And that's actually fairly easy to implement.
So it's not for game
cubes? Well, fun fact, MonoMod and Harmony and Zero Harmony were originally developed for game modding. And they're also the engine is also used in a lot of Unity games. so, yeah.